Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Murder at the Kennedy Center by Margaret Truman. Narrated by Richard Poe. This book is copyrighted 1989 by Margaret Truman. This recording is copyrighted 1990 by Recorded Books. Kenneth Ewald has what it takes to win the presidency. The support of his party, a lovely wife, a dynamic campaign. What neither he nor any candidate needs is a corpse. And now? Murder at the Kennedy Center.
Chapter 1. Moments ago, she'd been angry, and filled with the bravado such anger generates. She'd threatened. The volume of her voice kept low, the intensity high-pitched. Now she saw it. It was a revolver. Not a big one. There was a toy-like quality to it. "Don't be ridiculous," she said, her voice cracking, a tentative laugh behind the words indicating the fear that gripped her body. "No, please, don't do this. We can..." The gun was thrust forward, its short barrel ramming sufficiently hard into the softness of her belly to move her back a step. "Oh, no." She saw the finger squeeze the trigger. Her flesh muffled the report. The bullet penetrated her, taking with it muscle and nerve, bone and skin. It tore through her back, slower and wider than when it had entered. She was driven backward, her beautiful eyes open wide and fixed on the last sight they would ever see, the face of her murderer.
Chapter 2. "Well, Leslie, how does it sound to you?" The wife of Senator Kenneth Ewald smiled at Ed Farmer, her husband's campaign manager, an aide who seldom smiled himself. "Everything sounds wonderful, Ed. We all think we know about showbiz, but I had no idea how much was involved in putting together an event like this. Ken will be delighted."
"That's because it's a one-time event. Everything has to be invented or imported for the occasion," Farmer said in his characteristically flat tone. "There are very few genuine experts. It's like a presidential campaign."
The others in the Kennedy Center's George Rogers Clark room agreed that everything seemed to have been covered. Everything and everyone was in place, or would be. From above, ceramic birds and animals looked down on them as if holding a meeting of their own, or judging this one. The Marshall Bohm family had donated the room to the center, including the collection of ceramic wildlife, and it was a popular tourist stop. There had been more than 85 million visitors to the handsome, sprawling arts complex since its dedication in 1971. The Clark Bohm room was seldom used for meetings, but a socialite on the committee who liked little animal and bird sculptures had pulled strings.
"It's a shame Max Smith couldn't be at this final meeting," Mrs. Ewald said. "After everything he's done to help us get this started and on track and keep us legal. But his teaching comes first. It certainly looks as if it'll be worth the time and talent and money of everyone here, and we've certainly stocked the pond with celebrities."
"Boris," Farmer said, "have you any final comments?"
Seated at the opposite end of the table was a menacing man with a shaven head, hooked nose, and absolutely black eyes, like moles in his head. Boris Trenka was the Kennedy Center's artistic director. Trenka, who'd defected to the United States 10 years earlier, after many years as artistic director of Russia's Bolshoi, said in a low voice, thick with an accent,
"This is a television production. I know nothing of television."
Farmer sighed. That was all he had heard from Trenka since they began to work on a musical gala to advance the presidential candidacy and the coffers of Ken Ewald, senator from California.
"I don't think we should adjourn until George returns," said one of Trenka's aides. Another aide remarked, "I suppose he's still having trouble working out Sammy's transportation. There was a foul-up." I don't think we need to be concerned about the travel arrangements or the lives of the rich and famous, Farmer said. That's George's job.
I should hope it's not ours, said Trenka haughtily.
Farmer ignored him and looked at an attractive young woman seated to his left. The stars will get here. Anything we've neglected to cover, Andrea?
Andrea Feldman had worked with Ewald for a little over a year. Because a great deal of her 5 feet 9 inches was in her legs, she didn't appear to be tall when seated. She had thick black hair that hung loosely to her shoulders, and a face surprisingly fair, considering the dusky color of her hair and striking eyes. She wore a smartly tailored gray suit and a white blouse with a simple collar, and her makeup was so expertly applied as to be undiscernible. Her nails were without polish, and the only jewelry she wore was a simple gold band on the ring finger of her right hand. She smiled.
No, Ed, I think that covers it. With all the high-priced talent around here, I can't imagine anything going wrong.
The door opened, and Georges Abatiello entered the room. A veteran director of TV music specials, including the previous year's Grammy Awards, he was a short, slight man with thinning hair, a perpetual look of harassment, and hands in constant flight, small birds hovering around a feeder or a meeting.
Sorry I'm late, he said, but there's been a misunderstanding with Sammy's people.
He plopped in a chair next to Trenka and said,
Sammy's marvelous, just dances through these problems, you know. The old soft shoe.
He looked at Trenka.
Have I missed anything?
Trenka said,
I think not. There's little to miss.
Oh, there is something else, Andrea Feldman said, holding a finger in the air. Miss Gâteau's manager wants us to put her on later in the program.
Abatiello stood, hands moving. That's ridiculous. Impossible.
Why? Farmer asked.
Why? Abatiello said in a voice that had risen to fly with his hands. You don't just arbitrarily change the order of guest appearances. We've choreographed this down to the last second. The final version of the script is being typed at this moment. The orchestra has rehearsed everything in order. No. Tell Miss Gâteau's manager that one thing we don't need now is a diva's temperament.
He sat down, elaborately weary.
Why did you wait until now to bring this up, Andrea? Farmer asked.
I talked to her manager just an hour before the meeting and made a note to bring it up, only it got lost in the shuffle. She wasn't demanding it. She was very nice, actually.
I think it's ridiculous to have her on the program anyway, an Ewald media consultant said. The senator, as everyone knows, is a jazz lover. He knows nothing from opera, so why have an opera singer? Opera doesn't pull in many votes.
Jazz pulls in even fewer. Are we really going to debate this now? Farmer asked.
I disagree, said Trenka, the first hint of amusement in his voice all day. At least we will have some serious music represented.
The whole conversation is academic, Farmer said, closing the briefcase in front of him to make the point that he was about to leave. Rosanna Gâteau has been invited to participate, and she will. The senator likes jazz, but was especially pleased when she agreed to appear on his behalf, and that's that.
Farmer, a slender young man with rimless glasses, a hairline that had started its rapid rise in law school, and a fondness for colorful wide-striped shirts, bow ties, and penny loafers, had been with Ewald since the senator's early days in California as a national political figure.
What do you think, Mrs. Ewald? Andrea Feldman asked.
Leslie Ewald smiled.
I think I share Mr. Trenka's appreciation for having opera represented in the musical fair. I happen to particularly enjoy opera, and Ken loves jazz. One doesn't preclude the other. I think it's nice that both will be heard. Maybe we should include some rap music, too.
There were a few smiles.
Farmer stood. And, he said, let's not go changing performance schedules at this late date. The show is tomorrow, and there's enough for this committee to do to make sure the parties and such go well. Thank you all very much, ladies and gentlemen, for taking yet more time this afternoon.
To Andrea, he added,
call Miss Gâteau's manager. Tell him to convey to her that we love her, that it is too late to make changes, that her part of the show is prime time before audience fatigue sets in and before we lose part of the TV audience to a very popular network comedy that cuts in before we're finished. She's an artist. She'll understand.
Farmer and Leslie Ewell were the first to leave the room. As they led the two Secret Service agents into the upper lobby outside the Opera House, Farmer growled, "Stars, spare me." "I know, Ed, but it is wonderful that all these artists have agreed to appear on Ken's behalf tomorrow night. The jazz lineup alone reads like a who's who, and also having performers like Sammy Davis Jr. and Joan Baez is really an incredible affirmation of their belief in him." "More like a belief in having someone in the White House who appreciates them. Some of these performers aren't exactly what you'd call left-wing Democrats. Once they saw Ken pick up a head of steam in the primaries, they seemed to have forgotten the impurity of his ideology." He laughed scornfully. "Like all the other committee frauds." Ewald had come in fourth in the Iowa caucus in February, third in the New Hampshire primary the same month. There was talk of dropping out. Then he took 16 of the 19 states on Super Tuesday, March 8th. That was when Perry, Bradley, Cuomo, Gore, Nunn, and Alexander called it quits, leaving only Ewald and Jody Backus in the remaining pro forma races. Farmer and Leslie Ewald crossed the sprawling main lobby and passed through the Hall of Nations, the flags of all countries currently maintaining diplomatic relations with the United States lining the soaring white marble veneer walls above them. Farmer helped Leslie on with her raincoat and opened the door to the outside, where her limousine waited. "Ride?" she asked. "No, thanks. I'm going over to the office." The senator's private campaign office was across the street in the Watergate office building. Leslie extended her hand. Farmer took it. She said, "It's going to work, isn't it?" "The show tomorrow night?" "No, the campaign. He's going to become president." Farmer released her hand. "Let's just say things are looking good, but you never know. The last primary can't hurt him, and then the convention will be the coronation. As candidate. Unless something happens that throws everything off, which would open up the convention as it hasn't been open for years." She stared at him. He was never optimistic, which she often thought was unusual for the campaign manager of a man running for the White House. But every time she had those thoughts, she reminded herself that Ed was right, that in the rough and tumble, right and left, right or wrong, democracy called the United States, there should be no celebrating until the final ballot had been cast on November 8th, and until the Electoral College had pronounced its verdict. She said, "Thanks for everything, Ed. The gala is going to be wonderful. What a send-off to the convention! What a boost! I may even find it gala and relax and enjoy myself." When you think about boosts and liftoffs, remember NASA and the Challenger astronauts, Farmer cautioned darkly. Without another word, Leslie Ewald got into her limousine. Not far from Kennedy Center, in George Washington University's Lerner Hall, Mackenzie Smith peered over his lectern at the students in his crowded class on advanced criminal procedures. He was a craggy, fine-looking man in heavy, horn-rimmed glasses. "I think that does it for today," he said, running his fingers over stubble on his cheeks, which seemed to reappear in minutes no matter how many times he shaved. "Aside from the cases you've been assigned to analyze by the next time we meet, I have an additional assignment for you." He smiled as assorted groans welled up. "I expect you to watch the musical salute to Senator Ewell tomorrow night." A young man named Krause said, "Professor Smith, I thought the classroom was not to be used for political purposes." The other students laughed along with him. "Well, this classroom isn't," Smith said, closing his portfolio of lecture notes. "All I'm suggesting is that you take an hour out of your busy schedules and enjoy some good music. I expect well-rounded attorneys to graduate from this university." "Professor Smith," a young woman called. "Yes, Miss Riley." "When Senator Ewald is elected president, will you be his attorney general?" Smith sighed. He was tired of the subject. "If Senator Ewald becomes the next president of the United States, he will undoubtedly choose someone for that post who wants it. That rules me out." "Watch the show. You'll be quizzed on it." He went down H Street to 22nd, took a left to G,
stopped at DJ's fast break for a sandwich to go, and slowed to a leisurely walk in the direction of his home on 25th. The sky was overcast, and mist that threatened to degenerate into a drizzle gave the air a thick quality. It was early June, but felt like April, which, Smith reminded himself, was better than feeling like August in Washington, D.C. He pulled the collar of his raincoat up closer to his neck and thought of that question he'd been asked so many times since Ken Ewald seemed almost assured of his party's nomination. Max Smith and Ken Ewald went back a long time together. Their relationship wasn't intensely political. Smith had never been much interested in partisan politics, but certain issues, certain causes had always been dear to him, and he approved of Ewald's stance on them. They'd first met when Ewald had begun to push, vigorously and at great political risk, for legislation on gun control, particularly handguns. Smith, at the time, was one of Washington's most respected attorneys, especially in criminal law, and had been asked to testify at hearings held by Ewald's committee. Shortly after Max Smith's appearance, he received a call from Ewald inviting him to a dinner party at the senator's home. That began a limited friendship that had deepened over the years. It wasn't that they spent much time together. Their busy individual lives precluded that. But there were other parties, issues, occasional plane trips together, and Smith found himself not only the senator's friend, but an unofficial legal and at times personal advisor to Ewald and his family. Issues beyond gun control drew Smith to Ken Ewald. The current president, Walter Manning, had little interest in the arts, and his administration reflected it. Ewald, on the other hand, was the leading Senate voice in support of all things cultural. And every writer and artist, every musician and theatrical performing arts group in the country, knew that any slice of the federal pie designated for them was the direct result of these years of Ewald's unfailing championing of their cause. From Smith's perspective, Ewald was a well-balanced politician. As a freshman in Congress, he'd vigorously opposed the war, yet was a staunch supporter of maintaining military superiority over the Soviets. He'd called for a return of a WPA, in which all able-bodied welfare recipients would work or undergo training while collecting assistance, except the mentally ill, homeless, and AIDS victims. He had his faults, of course, but Smith had few reservations about supporting the man in his run for the White House, especially after the reign of Walter Manning. Smith turned the corner at 25th and headed for home, his narrow, two-story taupe brick house with trim, shutters, and front door painted federal blue. Attorney General, he thought. It brought a smile to his face. He had thought of many things he might be interested in doing with the rest of his life, but being directly involved in executive branch politics was not on the list. He opened the door and entered the place that had been home for the past 7 years. Rufus greeted him with unwelcome enthusiasm. "Stay down," Smith said, pushing on the blue Great Dane's huge head. When Rufus stood on his hind legs, he looked his master in the eye. Smith answered the ringing phone in his study, making sure to put his sandwich on top of the refrigerator, out of Rufus's reach.
"Mac, it's Leslie."
"Hello, Leslie. How are you?"
"Tired, but happy. I just came from the final meeting on the show and party. It's going to be lovely, Mac. I'm so excited."
"Splendid. I assume Ken shares your enthusiasm."
"I think so, although I haven't seen him enough to find out. I'll be glad when the last of the primaries is over. The convention is behind us, and..."
Smith laughed. "And you're choosing drapes for the Oval Office."
"I don't dare say it. Bad luck to say such things. At least that's what gloomy Ed Farmer would say."
"Somehow, Leslie, I don't think luck will have much to do with it."
"I just wanted to tell you how well the meeting went, and to thank you again for your help."
"I didn't do much."
"More than you think. It's always comforting to have the clear-headed wisdom of Mackenzie Smith on tap. I've got a last-minute idea Boris and George won't like. I have to run, Mac. See you tomorrow. Don't forget to shave and wear a clean shirt." Chapter 3.
Ken Ewald, senior U.S. Senator from California, stood alone in the anteroom behind the president's box in the Kennedy Center's Opera House.
Chairs upholstered in a white, green, and red floral pattern surrounded a glass-top coffee table. The carpet was the color of ripe cherries. Small paintings dotted pale green walls. He walked to where the seal hung next to the door and removed it from its hook. His fingers traced the raised wording. Seal of the President of the United States. The letters were in blue, the background gold. An eagle dominated the center, its breast a shield of red, white, and blue. The seal was always on the wall, unless the president and his party were attending an event in the opera house. When that happened, it was hung in front of the box for the audience to see. Tickets to the box were part of the president's patronage, to give if he wished to share them. Otherwise, the box stood empty during performances. Ewald opened the door and stepped into the box. Below were 2,300 empty seats. The party to kick off that night's musical gala was in progress on stage. Ewald had been down there moments before. Bored, he'd wandered up to the box. The lead Secret Service agent assigned to him for the night, Robert Geraldson, remained outside in the foyer on Ewald's instructions. He looked down at the stage where Leslie and their son Paul and daughter-in-law Janet stood with some of the celebrities who would perform that night. His physical distance from them at that moment was symbolic. Never before had he and Leslie worked so closely together, yet he knew the inherent pressures of seeking the presidency created tremendous and understandable pressures on her and on their marriage. A politician's wife, she garnered more votes than any platform could. He surveyed the stage for other familiar faces. They certainly were there, some pleasing, others representing necessary evils. He looked around the empty box and wondered at those who'd occupied the White House in the past. Some had spent considerable time in this presidential box. Others, like the sitting president, Republican Walter Manning, had been openly without interest in the artistic events that gave life to the nation's cultural center. He looked down at the seal in his hands and was suddenly overwhelmed at the significance of the office it represented. The decision to run for president had not come easily to him. He'd spent countless hours of private debate over whether he was indeed qualified to lead a nation that not only was the most powerful on earth, but meant so much to him. He knew he was up to the task as far as experience and insight into the workings of government went. Years in Congress, first in the House, then in the Senate, had given him a broad and deep understanding of how things worked, how things got done. But was that enough? Did he want it badly enough? Was there enough of the proverbial fire in his belly to carry into the job itself? He thought back to when Eugene McCarthy had sought the presidency. McCarthy had been on a television talk show. The host, Ewald couldn't remember who it was, commented that certain critics of McCarthy claimed he did not want to be president bad enough, to which McCarthy replied, in his urbane manner, "No one should want to be president that bad." McCarthy had gone on to say, during that interview, that he thought every president should take off one day a week to read poetry or to listen to music. Ewald had smiled at that comment. It represented, to some extent, his own feelings, even though he knew the suggestion was impractical. He also thought back to Ronald Reagan, the only president who seemed to come out of the White House looking better and almost younger than when he'd entered. Days off to read poetry and listen to music, or to watch old Western movies. Perhaps. It didn't really matter. The fact was, Ken Ewald did want to be president of the United States, because he felt the things he believed in were good for the country, would take it from a White House mortgaged to big business, oil, and the furthest right of military interests, and return it to a White House in which people mattered more than machines and money. He went back to the anteroom and hung the seal on the wall. Critics said that he was naive in some of his plans involving social welfare. There were his own dark moments when he thought they might be right, that the only way to govern America was to be hard-nosed, isolated, ruthless. Maybe. But even in those small hours, he told himself that he was not without his own hard edges, his own recognition that to govern effectively was to compromise, to allow pragmatism to take the edge off dreams. He was ready to do that. His dreams would be accommodated in the larger context of being president. First, you had to win. You had to be there if any part of any dream was to be realized. By the time he returned to the stage, the party had gained momentum. Ewald was delighted to see Paul. His son's successful import-export business had kept him in the Far East for 2 weeks, and there had been a question whether he would make it back in time for this salute to his father. Ewald had to smile as he thought of the telephone conversation they'd had a few days ago. Paul had called from Hong Kong, and after some talk about how well the campaign was going, he'd concluded with, "Dad, you know I'll be there if I have to rent a Chinese junk and row it all the way back myself." Ewald often told his friends that if you were going to have only one child, you were lucky to have one like Paul. His daughter-in-law was another story. Small and slender, lips abstemious and poorly defined on a pinched face, Janet was a moody young woman, at least when Ewald was around her, which he was grateful wasn't often. What his handsome, successful son saw in her was beyond him, although he'd settled long ago on her superior bosom, surprising for such an otherwise meager frame. Ed Farmer joined him. Ewald grinned, nodded, and said, "She's a beautiful woman, isn't she?" Referring not to Janet, but to Rosanna Gatteau, surrounded by a group of admirers off to the side of the 64-foot-deep stage, a stage almost as large as the Metropolitan Opera House at New York's Lincoln Center or Russia's Bolshoi. His campaign manager said nothing. "Just lusting in my heart," Ewald said, his smile expanding at the corners of his mouth. That smile and the form it took was part of the boyishness that balanced the crags and lines in his tan face. Soft, curly brown hair helped, too. He was 46, one of the youngest presidential candidates since John Kennedy. Farmer looked meaningfully in the direction of a Washington columnist stationed nearby behind a glass of champagne. "Keep those lines to yourself until after you're president, Senator," Farmer said sharply. "Come on, we need photos." Ewald watched Rosanna Gatteau move gracefully to where a pianist, bassist, and violinist recruited from the National Symphony played show tunes, their melodies floating harmlessly up into a canyon of lights, pipe battens, grids, fly lines, and counterweight pulleys. "Let's do some photos," Farmer repeated. "Now?" "Yes. How often are all of you together? We'll pose you with some of the stars, then do the family." Farmer gripped Ewell's arm and guided him to where his family stood with a few of the artists who would appear later that night. Ewald extended his hand to the pianist Oscar Peterson. "I've been collecting your records ever since they came out of Canada on 10-inch discs," Ewald said. Peterson shook Ewald's hand and smiled.
"That's nice to hear, Senator. You're talking about a long time ago."
"Yes, I know," Ewald said. "I was turned on to jazz in my early teens. I remember very well the first two records I ever heard. Really heard, that is. One featured you. It might have been your first recording. The other was a Dixieland album led by Muggsy Spanier."
"Well, that's an eclectic beginning," said Peterson, considered among the greatest pianists in the history of jazz.
Leslie Ewald joined them. Ewald turned next to Sarah Vaughan.
"I've been a fan of yours for almost as long, Miss Vaughan.
I still say the record you cut for Imarcy when you were 19, the one with Clifford Brown, Herbie Mann, and Jimmy Jones, is the finest jazz vocal album ever recorded.
My wife will testify to the fact that it's played loud and often in our house."
She thanked him.
"How nice it will be to have a president of the United States who appreciates American music."
Ewald laughed. "More than just appreciates it. Devoted to it is more like it. I plan to have regular jazz concerts at the White House."
"Provided you get the nomination and are elected, Ken," Leslie Ewald said.
His smile never broke, but there was a fleeting anger in his eyes as he looked at her.
Peterson graciously excused himself. Sarah Vaughan turned to Ewald and said,
"I understand one of your favorite songs is Love a Man."
"That's right.
I'll be singing it tonight, just for you."
"Wonderful. I can't wait."
The singer walked away to join trumpeter Ruby Braff, bassist Ron Carter, and drummer Mel Lewis, who were laughing at a joke one of them had told. Farmer had collared the campaign photographer and set up shots of Ewald and family with some of the jazz musicians. When they were through, Ewald turned to his son.
"I'm very happy you could make it back, Paul. This whole thing wouldn't have meant nearly as much without you."
"Well, I have to admit that rowing that junk took something out of me, but here I am."
They both laughed. Ewell turned to his daughter-in-law and asked how she was.
"Just fine," Janet replied. To Paul, she said, "Let's go."
"They want a picture of us, son."
Paul looked at his wife.
"Two more minutes, Janet. I want my picture taken with the next president of the United States."
Janet tugged Paul's arm.
"Please.
Take the picture," Leslie Ewell said to the photographer. She moved close to her husband. Janet was at Ewell's other side.
"Big, happy smiles on everyone," Farmer said. "This is a gala."
Ewell put his arm around his wife and smiled, exposing a solid set of white teeth. Leslie's smile matched his in intensity and attractiveness. As the photographer tripped the shutter and the strobe went off, Paul turned to look at his father. His expression was one of sincere admiration. Janet Ewald, her delicate clasped hands a fig leaf below her waist, managed to look as though she suffered only minor pain. After a dozen more shots had been taken of the family, Ken and Leslie posed together, just the two of them. Having their picture taken obviously caused them no discomfort. Every shot was smooth, quick, candidate and wife at a celebrity cocktail party at the National Arts Center named after John F. Kennedy, whom Ewald frequently quoted in his speeches. He was a Kennedy man, part of the cosmetic as well as ideological legacy, cut from the same political cloth, tailored and barbered to heighten the effect, and every bit as handsome and charming. After 8 years of a conservative administration, the country seemed ready for a return to Camelot. Ewald felt confident that in the general election in November, he could defeat the current Vice President of the United States, Raymond Thornton, the obvious Republican nominee. For a time, he'd been less confident about the Democratic convention in July in San Francisco, where he would have to bring in enough delegates to defeat his chief opponent for the nomination, Southern Senator Joseph Jody Backus, the leader of the conservative wing of the Democratic Party, preferably by the second ballot, after the favorite's sons and daughters and such. Backus had started strong in the early primaries, but had fallen behind. Still, the party had changed dramatically as the nation shifted into a more conservative stance. Liberal Democratic beliefs had been denigrated again. There were still some powerful Democrats who were convinced that a candidate like Ken Ewald, with his well-documented commitment to the sort of social programs that seemed to scream of big government expenditures, was anathema to the majority of the electorate, Republican and Democrat alike. It needn't be that way. Not all progress and programs required billions. But Jody Backus, even though the numbers coming out of the primaries had placed him behind Ewald in Democratic voter preference, retained considerable clout within the party. Now, with the latest changes in regulations, you could win the primary battle and lose the war. Yes, Ken Ewald was confident he could defeat Raymond Thornton in November. But first he would have to work down to the wire to ensure his nomination in July. Tonight's televised gala from the Kennedy Center would help. Jerry Fielding, a congresswoman from Northern California and an ally, walked up, smiling.
"What are you going to do for an inaugural gala, Ken?" she said.
"With this big production number tonight for a mere candidacy. Remember, for one event, Bush had Sinatra and Baryshnikov and Arnold Schwarzenegger." Ewald said,
"We're doing the Messiah, and I'm singing the title role."
A white-jacketed waiter carrying leftover hors d'oeuvres passed the Ewalds. The senator picked up a spanakopita from a silver tray and popped the phyllo pastry filled with spinach and cheese into his mouth.
Leslie started talking with other people, freeing him to wander away. Farmer at his side, Agent Geraldson maintaining his usual watchful but discreet distance behind. Ewald stopped to exchange banalities with friends.
"Looks like campaigning agrees with you, Senator. Your wife looks as lovely as ever, Ken, and you seem to be holding up, too."
Or to be gracious to strangers who wished him well in his pursuit of the nomination.
"No, Jody Backus and I work closely together in the Senate. It's just that we see things a little different sometimes."
He left the theater, stood on the landing, and looked out over the red-carpeted grand foyer, longer than 2 football fields.
"You can lay the Washington Monument in it and still have room to spare," the tour guides all said.
18 Swedish crystal orifice chandeliers, each weighing a ton, cast uncertain light over the expanse. Ewald saw through floor-to-ceiling windows that a jet aircraft, its whine snuffed out by the building's impressive soundproofing, was making its approach to National Airport just across the Potomac. He started down the stairs when a
"Good evening, Senator,"
stopped him. Ewald turned to face Mackenzie Smith.
"Be back in a minute," the farmer said.
"Hello, Mac," Ewald extended his hand.
"You look bored," Smith said.
Ewald laughed.
"I can't be bored at my own party, can I? Even if it's just another excuse for photo opportunities. I think the bash after the show will be a hell of a lot pleasanter. I assume you know, Mac, how much I appreciate your efforts in helping me put this night together."
Smith shrugged.
"I always wanted a chance to rub shoulders with stars. Now I'm getting my chance."
"And?"
"It was less exciting than my mother told me it would be. You should be in your element tonight, Ken. Lots of good jazz to be heard."
"Yes, I love it. Of course, you'll have your addiction to opera satisfied, too."
"That's true. Although, as with any addiction, the craving only grows stronger after each fix."
"How's Leslie?"
"Fine. Under some strain, but still comes up smiling."
Smith was 2 years Ewell's senior. His body was cube-like, not fat, but square, solid. He'd been a star linebacker at the University of West Virginia. Ewald's tall, slender physique was more that of a basketball player. Indeed, he'd been enough of a court performer at Stanford to make the Pacific Coast All-Star team, second string, with the second string usually omitted from biographies prepared by his office. Smith had shaved just before coming to the party, but a heavy 5 o'clock shadow said he hadn't. His head was covered with a close crop of salt-and-pepper hair. His eyes were the color of Granny Smith apples. The nose was prominent, his chin jutting and strong. He looked at Secret Service Agent Geraldson and said to Ewald, "I could never get used to that." When Ewald didn't respond, Smith added, "Spending my life being watched." Ewald had been distracted by a couple who'd carried their drinks to the grand foyer and stood gazing up at the 7-foot-tall, 3,000-pound bronze Robert Burke's bust of President Kennedy. He gave his attention back to Smith.
"Oh, I agree, Mac. Having these guys sleep with me is the only reason I ever considered not running."
Smith smiled and looked down at his empty glass.
"I think I'll get a refill before the show starts." "Well, that's 3 hours away. You must be getting desperate."
"Where's Anne?" Ewald asked. Annabelle Reed had been Smith's companion for a number of years.
"Out of town, Ken. The irony of it. Here I am involved with my first and last television extravaganza, and she picks tonight to be away on business. She'll be watching at her hotel. See you later, and break a leg."
Ed Farmer, the rest of the Ewald family in tow, came to where the candidate stood alone.
"Time to go to the hotel, Senator," Farmer said. It was now 6 o'clock. The performance would begin promptly at 9.
They'd taken a suite at the Watergate across the street rather than have to return home to kill time.
"Okay," Ewald said. Then, almost to himself, he added, "I wish he'd change his mind."
"Who?" Farmer and Leslie asked in concert.
"Max Smith. He'd be a tremendous asset to us."
"He already has been," Leslie said.
I know, Ewald said as they walked down the stairs to the foyer. I was surprised he agreed to get involved at all, considering his disdain for vulgar politics. Maybe it'll give him a taste of campaign excitement, and he'll decide to get more active with us. He'd make a hell of an advisor on drugs and other crimes, and a great attorney general.
Chapter 4. In another suite at the Watergate, Sammy Davis Jr. was playing Pac-Man. The electronic game traveled with him wherever he went. A quart bottle of strawberry soda with a straw was at his side. Half a case of it sat in the corner of the living room.
"I know how last minute this is, Sammy," George Abbatiello said from where he sat on a leather bar stool, "but I really would like to accommodate Mrs. Ewald. She's a nice lady. She called me a half hour ago and asked if you and Rosanna Gatteau would do a duet. She remembers seeing you do one at some benefit in Vegas a year or two ago. She said she was reluctant to ask because Rosanna had requested a last-minute change in the schedule and we turned her down, but then she figured nothing ventured, nothing gained. Would you be willing to come on again and do a duet with Rosanna? We'll find time by shortening up on the jam sessions."
"Hey, man, happy to. The lady's a gas." He continued to play the game.
Abbatiello smiled. He knew Davis's reputation was that of easy cooperation, but he didn't expect him to be this easy. Things had begun to fall apart in the last hours leading up to the telecast, and George and his staff were in a mad scramble to straighten them out. He was used to dealing with the quibbles of performing artists, but most of the problems were coming from the political side. Politicians insisting they be on stage when Ewald and his family made an appearance. Security people questioning arrangements they should have thought of days before. Big egos clashing with bigger egos and lesser significance. He was glad he'd earned his ulcer in show business rather than the political arena. As he'd said to his wife a few minutes before, this was his first and last contribution to politics. Anybody's politics. Davis lost the round.
"I'll beat this sucker yet," he said, laughing loudly, and joined Abbatiello at the bar. "You want a soda?"
"No, thanks, Sammy," Abbatiello checked his watch. "Give me a fast rundown of how the duet goes, timing and such, and the sheets. We need the lead sheets for the orchestra."
Davis's musical director, who'd been dozing in a large leather chair, came to life and worked with Abbatiello on the changes. At precisely 9 o'clock, with the opera house filled with Ewald supporters and friends of supporters out for a pleasant evening, and maybe to be seen, the curtain rose, the orchestra launched into a spirited, jazz-flavored arrangement of California, Here I Come, and the musical gala in honor of Senator Kenneth Ewald began. As it turned out, the impromptu duet between Sammy Davis Jr. and Rosanna Gatteau was the hit of the evening. They romped through a medley of old and familiar songs like Baby It's Cold Outside and A Bushel and a Peck, the elegant and beautiful diva, the perfect foil for the talented, manic, and considerably shorter Davis. Host David Letterman delighted the largely Democratic audience with barbed one-liners about the current administration, who was manning the Manning, etc., and roasts of the Republican Party in general. And Joan Baez quietly transported those old enough to remember the 1960s back to that quaint period.
The finale was to be a jam session featuring all the jazz musicians who'd appeared in smaller groups. Just before Letterman announced that they would play Ellington's Take the A-Train, Ewald and his family were brought up on stage. A restriction imposed by the Kennedy Center management was that there would be no overt political speech-making during the evening. Ewald, who had no intention of violating that, simply said, "The kind of artistic and creative energy displayed here tonight is symbolic of what this great nation has always spawned in its excellence and diversity and community." He turned and looked at his family, smiled broadly, and went on, "And all of us thank each and every person who has made this night so memorable. We are deeply grateful." Then, on cue, he turned to the assembled musicians and said, "Okay, they said I could count this one off." He tapped his foot and counted 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Oscar Peterson began the intro, and the Ewalds were led from the stage to take their seats again in the front row. The finale was slightly disjointed and cheerful, as such numbers tend to be, but well received. The party preceding the performance had been small, the guest list carefully considered. Now the larger party began. Had the weather been nasty, the grand lobby would have been used. Because the weather had turned nice, it was held on the vast wraparound terrace of the Kennedy Center. Mac Smith, who'd quickly grown weary of being congratulated for having helped put together the evening, got himself a scotch and soda and found a relatively private spot on the west side of the terrace. People were milling everywhere. A six-piece band played hyper-amplified rock and roll, and hundreds of guests, young and old, gyrated to the rhythms on a large dance floor. Smith was thinking of Annabel Reed and what she might be doing at that moment in New York when the bulky body and round face of Jody Backus circumvented knots of people and headed his way. Ewald had insisted that all his Democratic rivals be invited, and most of them had showed up, including Senator Backus. Smith had met Backus a number of times at social gatherings. Although the conservative senator represented few political and social ideas shared by Smith, he'd enjoyed those previous meetings, for Backus was a jovial, easy-talking conversationalist with a bottomless reservoir of anecdotes and a tendency toward blunt truth. "Hello, Senator," Smith said, extending his hand. Backus took it in one of his own large hands and shook his head. "Looks like you and my dear colleague from the Senate pulled off quite a coup here tonight, Mac Smith." "With lots of help," Smith said.
"I'm impressed. Nobody helping this old boy has come up with anything this good."
Smith laughed. "We had a few moments of inspiration, that's all.
And tons of bucks, I'd say. Good thing Ken's daddy made all those millions out in California. All that talent really worked for nothing?"
Smith nodded. "They were the only people who worked for nothing. You're right, Senator, it cost quite a few bucks." Backus and Smith looked out over the crowd.
"That's one thing about us Democrats that the Republicans don't have," Backus said.
"What's that, Senator?"
"The ability to have a hell of a good time."
"You ought to make sure that it's written into this year's platform," Smith joked. "A good time will be had by all and twice in every pot." Backus thought for a second, then laughed. He shook Smith's hand again and said,
"I just want you to know, Mac, that if I don't manage to get me the nomination in July, your man has my support 100%, and he can count on it."
Smith started to say that Ken Ewald was not exactly his man, but decided to hold off. Backus waved and walked away, and Smith was joined by a plainclothes friend who was part of the center's security staff. Together, they enjoyed watching the characters and the dancing, some skillful, some merely animated. During the slower numbers, Ed Farmer danced sedately with a gray-haired woman, the wife of the majority leader, but was interrupted after a few minutes, naturally, by a phone call. Ken Ewald and his wife made a comfortable portrait of grace and motion and drew applause. The beat changed and the volume increased. Andrea Feldman, the young woman on Ewald's staff who'd been so helpful in setting up the gala, had captured the attention of others on the dance floor as she expended frenetic and somewhat erotic energy with a tall, handsome young blonde man who'd removed his suit jacket and who wore red, white, and blue striped suspenders over his white shirt. Andrea's purple silk dress closely followed every contour of her splendid figure. Around her waist was a vibrant belt, more a sash, created of multicolored feathers from exotic birds.
"I'd like to see you out there dancing like that, Mac," the security man said. "I would, except Annie isn't here."
He smiled at the image. He had little taste whatsoever for most of today's popular music and preferred his dancing to be quiet and pleasant, bodies gently touching, a soothing melody and subtle beat in the background. The band ended the song it was playing, and Farmer took the microphone. After congratulating everyone who had played a hand in creating the evening, he asked for a warm round of applause for the next president of the United States, Ken Ewald. The applause he wanted was forthcoming, and Ewald bounded up onto the bandstand and took the microphone. As he began, Mac Smith thought, he's an effective speaker in any situation, no doubt about that, and always natural. And in a nation that thought itself suspicious of oratory, what a wonderful and critical ability that was for anyone seeking office, seeking success in any endeavor, for that matter. This night, Ewald almost threatened to burst with honest enthusiasm. and when he'd finished his brief talk, the applause was twice as loud as when he'd been announced. Suddenly, a detonation of Vesuvius fountains and Catherine wheels sprayed broad strokes of lacquered, multicolored light, greens and reds and yellows, across the black sky, the vividness of the colors dissipating as they trickled down the canvas to the horizon. All eyes turned in the direction of the fireworks. Oohs and ahs blended with the snap, crackle, and pop of the display. The sky show lasted 10 minutes. As the last traces of sulfurous smoke wafted toward the party and the applause by a few overzealous souls continued, the band began playing, the dancers flocked to the floor, the portable bars were surrounded once again, and the party moved back into high gear. Washingtonians were often ready to party, Smith thought, for what they did by day was no party. For the party, perhaps, but no fiesta. He waited until he felt it was appropriate for him to leave, a few minutes before midnight on his watch, and sought out those to whom he should say goodbye. He started toward the Ewalds, but they were busy. He thought of Andrea Feldman, but saw that she was in a shadowed area of the terrace talking with a man who looked like Ed Farmer, and although Smith could not hear what they were saying, their faces and body language suggested that theirs was not a pleasant chat. He found a few others he was looking for, then left the Kennedy Center, enjoying the pristine night that had displaced the wet weather of the previous day. As soon as he entered his Foggy Bottom home 10 minutes later, he threw off his raincoat and called Annabelle at her New York hotel.
"It was a wonderful show, Mac," she said. "I loved every minute of it."
"Thanks. From a pragmatic point of view, everything worked. Everyone seemed to be happy with it. We'll pay the bills. Make some money. Advance the candidacy. And I'm glad it's over. As little as I had to do with it, it still took too much of my time. How are things with you?"
"Fine. My dinner with the investors went well. Damn, Mac, I'm sorry I couldn't be there, but you know that..."
"Annie, when you have serious investors from Europe who tell you the only time they can meet you is for dinner one evening, you don't beg off because you have a party to go to. Of course I understand. I'm just glad it went well. When are you coming home?"
"I'm shooting for the noon shuttle. I'll go directly to the gallery."
"I'll call you there."
"Call me every minute. I miss you, Mac."
"I miss you, too. Although I have to admit that what I missed most was not being able to do the funky chicken with you."
"Mac, are you..."
She started to laugh, wished him a good night's sleep, and they ended the conversation. 11 o'clock was Smith's usual bedtime. This night, however, he found himself wide awake and picked up where he'd left off reading Edmund Wilson's The 30s. He finished a series of entries on the famous Scribner's editor Max Perkins and looked at the regulator clock in his study. It was almost 4 in the morning. Smith marked his place with a bookmark and said to Rufus, "Come on, it isn't often you get to be walked at this hour." He put on a George Washington University windbreaker, slipped the choke chain over Rufus's head, and they went out to the street. It was a beautiful night, or morning. Smith breathed deeply, and a smile crossed his face. He was one of those people who was profoundly affected by the weather, hating the hot and humid summers, growling about the icy winters that sent inexperienced D.C. drivers sliding into each other with frightening regularity, and loving times like this, feeling good and doubly alive because of them. "Come on, Rufus, let's move and get some air in our lungs." There was no such thing as a brisk walk with Rufus. The Dane was too interested in stopping to smell territorial markers left by previous visitors. They meandered, stopping and going, in the direction of the Kennedy Center, where only hours earlier there had been so much activity, so much gaiety. Now everything was still. Lights from the center shone brightly in the black night. They had to wait at a corner as a D.C. cab careened past them viciously. "Dumb bastard," Smith snarled as he watched the red taillights disappear around the corner, but decided nothing must spoil his mood. He looked left and right, then set off at a trot across the broad avenue separating the center from where they'd stood. The man and the dog slowed to a walk and went up the ramp leading to the center's front entrance. Smith had never walked Rufus there before, but then again, he had never been out quite this late with his best friend before. There was little for the nosy canine to investigate on the ramp. They stopped to look down over the Potomac for a few minutes, then turned and retraced their steps back in the direction of the house, walking this time on the far side of the fountain. Smith hesitated in front of a massive horizontal relief that was the centerpiece of a small park-like area, the relief called War and Peace. A plaque on it read, America, 1965-1971, donated by the government of the Federal Republic of Germany. It's funny, Smith thought, how much of the Kennedy Center had been given by other governments, other nations. The intimate terrace theater had been a gift of Japan. The huge chandelier in the opera house was from the people of Austria. Marble lining the grand halls came from the citizens of Italy. Paintings from Peru. Meeting rooms through the generosity of Africa and Israel. Sculpture from Great Britain. Foreign tributes everywhere to the American Arts Center that had been conceived by President Eisenhower, nurtured by Lyndon Johnson, and eventually designated as the only memorial in the nation's capital to the slain John F. Kennedy. Smith had taken the tour of Kennedy Center more than once, and had been privy to many of its inner dimensions at meetings and social events. No matter how many critics had taken aim at Edward Durell Stone's long, horizontal architectural approach, Smith was glad it was there, and that he lived near it. It was, in effect, the centerpiece of his neighborhood, and he always felt a particular pride in what it symbolized. Funny, too, how a structure so full of life a few hours earlier could be so devoid of it now. "Come on," he said, yanking at Rufus's leash. Rufus balked. Because of his size and strength, when the dog balked, he almost always prevailed. The Dane pulled hard as he tried to go behind the relief to where a small cluster of wooden benches provided seating in the midst of carefully tended shrubs, bushes, and small trees. "Oh, come on, Rufus, we don't want to go back there." Rufus kept up the pressure on his leash. Smith finally gave up and went with him. Once behind the relief, Smith tried to see what the Dane would wet down or what had captured the dog's attention. A half moon provided some illumination. The first thing Smith saw was a long, colorful feather on the ground. Rufus sniffed it and continued pressing into the shrubbery. "Hey, Rufus, what are you..." Then he saw what the dog was after. A silk-stocking female foot. A shoe with a medium heel rested close to it. "Damn," Smith muttered, as he shortened the leash and moved closer, fearing to interrupt something private. Now the length of a shapely leg was visible. And then, the woman. Her skirt hiked up her thighs. Rufus, as though understanding what was at stake, stopped pulling and stood at attention, a low growl coming from his throat. Smith pushed aside a low branch. He saw what he sensed was the full body, and knew immediately who it was by the exotic feather belt around her waist. "Good God," he whispered as he stepped over her legs. Andrea Feldman's arresting eyes were wide open, but gone to glass. Her mouth was open as well. Blood had oozed from her chest through the fabric of her dress. Her purse was on the ground. It had opened, and its contents bled into the dirt, too. Smith crouched and took her wrist. Then he looked at the debris of her death. Lipstick, a small makeup mirror, a pen, and a key, obviously from a hotel. Smith read the writing on the large red plastic tag attached to it. Buccaneer Motel, Roslyn, Virginia. The numeral 6 was also imprinted on the tag. He led Rufus to the front of the relief, looked for someone, saw no one, and quickly ran, the dog leading the way, to the house, where he burst into the living room, thumbed through his phone book until he found the number he wanted, and dialed. A deep, sleepy voice answered. "Joe, Max Smith. I'm sorry to wake you, but there's been a terrible accident. Maybe a murder." Joe Riga, chief of detectives of Washington's MPD, was now awake.
"Where? Who?"
"A young woman named Andrea Feldman, who worked on Ken Ewald's staff. I was walking my dog near the Kennedy Center and found the body."
"Why didn't you call 911,
Joe, I don't know what this means, but I have to...
Well, there could be ramifications. Considerable ramifications. If you want me to call 911, I will, but..."
"No, Max, sorry, I even suggested it."
"I understand. Where's the woman, the body? You sure she's dead?"
"Okay, forget that last."
Behind the large relief across the fountain from the Kennedy Center, in front. She's in the bushes.
I'm on my way.
Fine, I'll meet you there. And Joe, I would appreciate it if we could keep this quiet for a few hours.
We can keep it quiet until I see the body and call it in. I can't do more than that. It probably won't keep for long anyhow. You know this town.
Sure do. And thanks.
You can make a positive ID on her, Mac? Riga asked as they stood over the body.
Yes, her name is Andrea Feldman.
Riga handed Smith the flashlight he carried, squatted, took the chin between his thumb and index finger, and gently moved her jaw back and forth. Still slack, he said. He slid his hand down the top of her dress and nestled it in her armpit. Didn't happen long ago, he said as he removed his hand and stood. Still some warmth. I'll call it in.
Joe, maybe you can do one favor, a legal one.
What?
Let me get hold of Ewald and tell him what's happened before the identification is announced. All I need is 1 hour, or even a few minutes.
No problem.
Riga called in for backup and a forensic unit to come to the scene.
Identity of victim uncertain, he said into his radio.
Smith thanked him and returned home, where he dialed the Ewald house. A sleepy Leslie answered. Leslie, it's Max Smith. Sorry to be calling at this hour, but this is important. Is Ken there?
Yes. Why?
Leslie, Andrea Feldman has been murdered. There was silence on the other end of the line. I was walking Rufus and discovered her about an hour ago. Someone shot her outside the Kennedy Center, across from the main entrance.
Mac, this is dreadful. Who could have done such a thing? Where is her family?
I have no idea, but I thought Ken ought to know right away.
Of course.
She turned away from the mouthpiece and murmured. Ewald came on the line.
Mac, could you come here right away?
He asked.
Of course, but...
Please, Mac, come now.
Sure. Anybody there to make coffee at this hour?
Of course. This is unbelievable.
She was at the party. She was alive. I'm shocked. So was I. Hot, black, and strong. I'm on my way. Chapter 5. The stately, two-story, red-brick Ewald home was on the upper reaches of 28th Street in Georgetown. Behind it, Oak Hill Cemetery. The house sat on a rise of land, giving its occupants a view of the Dumbarton Oaks mansion and gardens. Smith pulled up in his blue Chevy Caprice and told one of the two uniformed security guards that he was expected. The guard used an intercom to confirm it and pushed a button that caused black iron gates to open electronically. Smith pulled into a circular driveway and was about to knock on the front door when Leslie Ewald opened it. Hello, Leslie.
Hello, Mac.
She looked past him to the front gate. Smith observed her closely. The flesh around her eyes was spongy, like putty that has been rubbed with a thumb covered with pencil lead. Lines that he hadn't noticed earlier in the evening seemed suddenly to have exploded at the corners of her mouth. She bit her lip, realized he was looking at her, realized he was there.
I'm sorry, Mac. Please forgive me. I hate having to...
She looked at the gate again. Smith, too, looked.
We've always had one guard. Now there are two. Ed Farmer had the extra sent over as soon as we told him about Ms. Feldman. They're going to install an electrified fence around the property, like one of those things that fries bugs.
She looked up at the portico roof.
Cameras, too. God, how I hate it all.
Beefing up security might be wise, Smith said, considering Andrea Feldman was a close working member of the staff. The media people and others will be all over you when it comes out.
Yes, I suppose you're right.
Let's go inside, Smith said. She ignored him and pointed to her left. Parked on the road at the corner of the property was a small white car.
Who's that?
He asked.
Press. They were at police headquarters. I suppose we'll end up being surrounded.
As she entered the foyer, she started to cry. Smith followed and shut the door behind them. She looked at him with round, moist eyes that were spilling tears down her cheeks. Her body heaved, and she threw herself against him. He wrapped his big arms around her thin shoulders and held her for a time, saying softly, "Easy, easy. It's terrible that Andrea Feldman has died, but you don't understand, Mac." "I assume I will quickly." "Yes, very quickly." She regained her composure, even forced a smile. "I haven't fallen apart in years." She took his hand. "Come, Ken and Ed Farmer are in the study." As she opened the door, Farmer came through it, followed closely by Ewald.
"Mac, it's good to see you. Thanks for being here," Ewald said, putting his hand on Smith's shoulder. "Back in a minute."
Leslie looked as if she might cry again, so Smith asked if he could have a drink before the coffee.
"It's been hours since the party."
He really didn't want one, but his strategy worked. She now had something to do. She quickly departed, leaving him alone in the paneled room. He'd been there before on dozens of occasions, yet for reasons he couldn't identify, it was strangely new to him at this moment. Two walls were taken up with floor-to-ceiling bookcases. A third wall contained cases with glass doors that housed Ewell's extensive collection of antique guns. A strange hobby, Smith often thought, for someone perpetually at war with the NRA.
"They're beautiful to look at, and they have great historic meaning. Shooting them is another matter," Ewald always said when questioned about it. Smith had always found Ewald somewhat enigmatic, predictable in a few unappealing ways, persuasively attractive in others. A human being.
Leslie returned, carrying a scotch on the rocks for him, a balloon glass containing a dark liquid for her, partly consumed. "Did I get it right, Mac? Scotch?"
"Yes, might as well stay with it."
"What are you drinking?" To keep her talking.
"Brandy and port. When Ken and I were in Scotland a few years ago, we took a particularly rough boat trip to the Orkney Islands. My stomach was queasy, and I asked the bartender for some blackberry brandy. He insisted a combination of port and brandy was more effective. He was right. I felt like throwing up ever since we got your phone call, but this settled my stomach right down."
When they were seated on adjoining flowered love seats around a leather-topped coffee table, Smith said,
"Okay, tell me about it. Don't mince words, just be direct. I know the death of anyone we know is terribly upsetting, but I'm reading into this something beyond that. Am I right?"
"Yes, you are very right."
"What am I right about?"
"I don't know where to begin. I suppose I should just tell you that..."
Ewald and Farmer returned. Ewald pulled a red Morocco leather chair on casters up to the table, settled his long, lean body in it, and crossed one leg over the other. The casualness of the pose in stark contrast to the tension-stiffened body of his wife. Farmer stood by a window behind Smith.
"Leslie was just starting to tell me about a particular concern you have with Andrea's death."
Ewald said to his wife,
"Go ahead, you might as well continue."
Smith couldn't decide whether Ewald was angry at Leslie, or feeling an anxiety that his outward appearance didn't reflect. Leslie shook her head and looked down at her drink.
"All right, I'll pick it up from there," Ewald said. "Evidently, Andrea was murdered with a weapon that belongs to me."
The expulsion of air through Smith's lips was involuntary and necessary. He sat back and listened to Ewald's further explanation.
"I've had a registered handgun in the house for years. Leslie had been expressing concern about the amount of time I'm away, and I thought simply having one on the premises would be comforting to her."
He looked at Leslie. She continued to stare down into her port and brandy.
"It was a small stainless steel Derringer, a 3-inch 45 caliber Colt. It's been sitting in a drawer in the bedroom for God knows how long. At any rate, after you called with the news about Andrea, I opened the drawer. Don't ask me why, but I did. The gun is gone."
"Who had access to it besides you and Leslie?" Smith asked. Ewald looked once again at his wife.
"Everyone in the house," she said.
"Family?" Smith asked.
"Yes, family, visitors, household staff, campaign staff, a cast of thousands."
Smith thought for a moment before asking, "Is that what's concerning you so? Or do you think that someone in this household is going to be accused of her murder?" Ewell didn't reply, but Leslie did, in a low, flat voice. "Yes." "Someone from your staff, Ken?" "No," Ewell said, looking at Leslie for the first time as if to receive approval of what he was about to say next.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.